Peter Gabriel has inhabited many roles, from a costumed prog poet in Genesis to a conservationist balladeer on the Wall-E soundtrack. However, his run of self-titled albums are where he found himself as a musician. On his third album in 1980, he took all the post-punk synth pop and world music happening around him and blended it into his twitchy, lopsided art rock. Gabriel spun tales of mental health disarray and anthems of dissatisfaction, and with the help of a French game show and Kate Bush, whistled his way to one of his biggest hits. This is New British Canon, and this is the story of Games Without Frontiers. Peter Gabriel left Genesis in 1975. Over the previous 7 years, they had grown from bafflingly strange prog hopefuls to one of Britain's biggest concert draws. Gabriel's role was partially as lyricist and vocalist, giving words and voice to the haunting ghost story of the musical box.
Play me my song. Here it comes again.
And the 23-minute good versus evil epic, Supper's Ready.
Hello, babe, with your guardian ass so blue.
But in a live setting, he would also embody the varied characters via flamboyant costumes, foxes in red dresses.
I'll be waiting in the song long.
Flower Men.
There's Winston Churchill dressed in rag. He used to be a British flag. Plastic man, what a drag.
And the bat-winged alien overlords.
Raising his eyes, beholds a lamb.
For their 1974 The Lamb Lies Down on Broadway double LP, he took full control of the lyrical direction to mix critical reaction and a downturn in commercial success in the UK, but increased interest in sales in the US.
We've gotta get in to get out.
Regardless, Gabriel had wanted to leave immediately after its release, and had told the band as such, but stayed on until the completion of their 1975 world tour. At the time, Gabriel claimed it was to spend more time in his vegetable patch. But this knowingly eccentric excuse covered a more human truth, being present for his growing family, especially his daughter, who'd endured a traumatic birth and had spent her first 6 months under observation. Alongside this, Gabriel tired of the never-ending album tour cycle. The principal plan when I left Genesis was to get out of the music business. I was not in love with its realities. We were getting successful, and knowing what we were going to do 18 months to 2 years ahead, I hated that. You couldn't be a free spirit anymore and respond to life as it arrived. You were a cog in a wheel. After a lengthy audition process to find Gabriel's replacement, Genesis settled on their drummer, Phil Collins, as their new singer and frontman. The music's as strong as it ever was. If it isn't, we won't play again. If it's not as good, there's no point in playing. Peter left and life goes on. We're all sort of sad. We spent some time trying to make him change his mind, but when he didn't, we just carried on. Free from the machinery of Genesis, alongside childcare, Gabriel would dive into study, reading voraciously about world religion, art and philosophy, as well as discovering a world of new music from Asia, Africa and South America, while at the same time becoming an early convert of punk and post-punk. Even attending early Sex Pistols shows. He would also take piano lessons, useful for communicating musical ideas more concisely than humming, as he had done as part of Genesis. By the end of 1976, the desire to get back into songwriting had consumed him. Tracking down Alice Cooper producer Bob Ezrin, he relocated to Toronto to begin work on his first solo endeavour. I particularly wanted to get away from my past. It would have been very easy for me to come up with another European, keyboard-orientated rock band. But that wouldn't have been right for me. That wouldn't have broken any new ground. For his first record, originally self-titled but since known as Car, Gabriel moved away from the sprawling epics and theatrical caricatures of his former group. A relatively stripped-down band, shorter, more tightly constructed songs, and lyrics with a far stronger emphasis on normal, human emotions, made the album as clean a break from Genesis as he could have hoped for. Between the fairy tale nightmare of Moribond the Burgermeister,
I'll go
And the apocalyptic Here Comes the Flood. Was first single Salisbury Hill. Climbing up on Salisbury Hill. It was in part a meditation on having the willpower to make a clean break from the past, with obvious parallels to Gabriel's post-Genesis life. Feeling part of the scenery. I walk right out of the machinery. With no chorus but a folkish acoustic riff provided by crack session man Steve Hunter, and a simplistic flute motif played by Gabriel himself. It epitomizes the carefree promise and excitement of taking a giant leap of faith. My heart going boom, 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 son, he said. It's strange that Salisbury Hill is a single, because at one point it wasn't going to be on the album. I'm pleased with it, especially from a feel point of view. It's got a kick time and that 7-4 rhythm works well because it feels like a normal rhythm, but isn't quite right. It's not like a clever rhythm, just a bit odd. It'll be interesting to see how people dance to it. Hitting number 13 on the UK charts and even making it to the Billboard Hot 100, Salisbury Hill showed that Gabriel could have success without Genesis. And with his former band's two albums since his departure both hitting the top 10 in the UK, it was a rare case of a band split where everybody won. Feeling that Bob Ezrin had overproduced much of his solo debut, Gabriel enlisted King Crimson's Robert Fripp for his next self-titled effort, commonly known as Scratch due to its artwork. It was more focused than his debut, but spikier and more unwieldy, inspired in part by Gabriel's appreciation for the newly popular punk movement. Despite major promotion, the Bowie-esque rubber soul of only single DIY failed to chart. Not that Gabriel really cared, more interested in creating personally challenging music than being commercially successful. It's like shaving my head. If I think I'm getting comfortable and complacent and falling into routine patterns, then I'll try to force myself to do something that will change everything. I like to put myself in positions where I have to examine things differently. And on his next album, he would do exactly that, changing everything. For his all-important third album, Gabriel would team up with up-and-coming producer-engineer duo Steve Lillywhite and Hugh Packham. Lillywhite had worked with some notable names in punk and post-punk. But what caught Gabriel's ear was their collaboration on XTC's Drums and Wires. When you leave me, I have difficulty concentrating. All this new music that was happening around him had lit a fire under Gabriel, an old prog head, absorbing not only the post-punk of XTC and Talking Heads, but elements of the Human League. And on No Self-Control, the looping marimba was inspired by the systems music of Steve Reich. Gabriel's plan was to create sounds that had never been heard before and meld them into a synth-pop, post-punk, pop-prog amalgam. Initial sessions for the album began in late 1979 in Peter Gabriel's barn in rural Bath, using a mobile studio, but later moving to townhouse studios in London. However, progress was slow going. His team of musicians, including drummer Jerry Marotta, synth player Larry Fast, guitarist David Rhodes, and temporary bassist John Giblin, often just waiting around for something to happen, filling time with rounds of croquet and table tennis. Peter would come in with rough ideas. I don't remember him ever really coming in with a song. I don't think he wanted to finalize things. He wanted to leave it open to see where it would go. And potentially it might go beyond his own comprehension. If we were building a house, there were no architectural plans. wanting to explore beyond what he had done before. Gabriel sought new means of songwriting. Larry Fast had introduced him to the Pyre rhythm box during the recording of his previous album. Having started as a drummer before being thrust into the frontman position, Gabriel quickly took to assembling his own drum loops using this device. It's very versatile. You can put in whatever drum patterns you like, and I would take an existing rhythm or invent one and put it on the drum box and write the song around that. It ended up I was doing much less in terms of chords and melodies. This rhythm-first philosophy would lead to the album's most enduring sonic textures. Alongside Marotta, Gabriel would bring in old friend and bandmate Phil Collins to provide beats. But as an experiment, Gabriel removed the metal from the drum kit. No hi-hats, no cymbals, no metallic clanging filling the sonic space. I have this theory that artists given absolute freedom die a horrible death. So when you tell them what they can't do, they get creative and say, oh yes I can, which is why I banned cymbals. Phil was cool about it. Jerry Marotta, the other drummer, did object, and it took him a while to settle into it. It's like being right-handed and having to learn to write with your left hand. It's a great challenge. Musicians should do it more often. Continuing the experiments with new technology, the townhouse's Studio 2 had a spiffy new solid-state Logic control desk with the ability to filter and compress the various recording tracks. This combined with Studio 2's cavernous stone room would produce one of the most iconic drum sounds of the 1980s. While Collins was tuning up, Pagum had pressed the reverse talkback button and Phil's weighty hits sounded huge, with the reverberations of each hit quickly being sucked into nothing. We heard this incredible sound suddenly coming through our loudspeakers in the control room. The reverse talkback mic circuit had a very, very heavy compressor on it. The effect was remarkable in the sound of the drum that came through. I think we were all in the control room together. Peter, Steve, me, Larry Fast probably, and whoever else. And everybody just went, wow. That's bloody incredible. This gate reverb drum sound would be best utilized on Intruder, with Collins creating a metronomic beat that would best show the eerie space between the monstrous hits. But would also appear throughout the LP. But Collins wasn't the only notable guest musician. Fripp would return to provide electric guitar on several tracks, while XTC's Dave Gregory would do the same on I Don't Remember and Family Snapshot. British jazz saxophonist Dick Morrissey would appear throughout. Who would be more well known a couple years later for playing on the disquieting love theme from Blade Runner. There was also Kate Bush. At the beginning of the 1980s, Peter Gabriel and Kate Bush occupied a similar art rock space in British music. Both sharing a propensity for theatrical characterization, sonic experimentation, and a mutual respect. Bush had grown up obsessed with Bowie, Elton John, and Roxy Music, but also the grandiosity and oddball storytelling of Genesis. Gabriel, however, learnt of Bush's existence like the rest of Britain when her gothic love story, Wuthering Heights, rocketed to number one in early 1978. They had first met in 1979 at a memorial for Mutual lighting crew member Bill Duffield, who had died tragically after falling through a trapdoor in the stage during Bush's Lionheart tour. Later that year, Gabriel had appeared on the Kate Bush Christmas special, not only performing his stirring take of Here Comes the Flood.
Lord, here comes the flood.
But duetting with her on a cover of Roy Harper's Another Day.
And just another day.
And without a sound.
So when recording Games Without Frontiers, and the original backing vocalist wasn't able to nail the French accent on the recurring motif, Gabriel phoned and Bush easily got a perfect take within half an hour. Everybody was falling all over Kate Bush. I don't know if it was Steve or Hugh, of course they were huge fans, but it was a huge race getting out to the control room to see who would get there first, to adjust her microphones or fix her headphones. She came with at least one of her brothers, some of her family bodyguards. She was just charming, just wonderful. The song itself had been ruminated on since the beginning of the sessions, initially merely a looping off-kilter synth line and beat titled Paper Moon. Continued jamming on the central motifs would yield the Human League synth bass sound. Fast's Wendy Carlos inspired synth classical phasing in the whistling section. And a full tape reel that was nothing but wordless, half-formed versions of Games Without Frontiers. As would be a continual hurdle throughout his later career, Gabriel found it difficult writing lyrics he was happy with. The album was start and stop, as Peter had to go off and write lyrics. I did the first Psychedelic Furs album in 11 days during a break from Peter's album. It was 3 or 4 months in total, which in those days felt like a long album. Eventually, the song would take its shape after Gabriel reflected on the popular family TV show It's a Knockout. Essentially, it was a school sports day for adults, with competitors from throughout Western Europe competing in races and obstacle courses, with oversized costumes and a whole lot of humiliation and falling in water. Originating in France as Jocelyne Frontier, legend has it was the idea of French President Charles de Gaulle as a way of healing post-war relations between France and Germany with a day of silly games. Gabriel took this incredibly naive take on foreign affairs, and from it produced the lyrics and title for Games Without Frontiers, the English translation of the show's French title.
Games without frontiers, war without tears.
Because what is war but the silliest of games? It seemed to have several layers to it. I just began playing in a somewhat light-hearted fashion. Hans and Lottie.
Hans plays with Lottie. Lottie plays with Jane.
So it looked, on the surface, as just kids. The names themselves are meaningless, but they do have certain associations with them.
Adolf builds a bonfire. Enrico plays with it.
So it's almost like a little kid's activity room. Underneath that, you have the TV program and the sort of nationalism, territorialism.
Andre has a red flag, Chiang Ching's is blue.
Competitiveness that underlies all that assembly of jolly people.
They all have hills to fly them on, except for Lintayu.
But some of the song's lyrics are less innocent and reveal humankind's penchant for evil in the guise of nationalism.
If looks could kill, they probably will.
Larry Fast had brought in the book Dispatches by Michael Hare, exploring the horrors of the Vietnam War. Gabriel latched on to its grim imagery. One of the most vivid ones was an American GI pissing on a dead Vietnamese soldier, and it was a reflection of what have we become as Americans that that could happen. That image found its way into the lyrics. Except Peter used goons in the jungle, instead of the derogatory term. Released as a single at the beginning of February 1980, 3 months ahead of the album, Gabriel ran into problems. For one, both the single and the album had been rejected by Atlantic, his US label. Then in the UK, Top of the Pops would not broadcast its original music video. The idea of the song was countries behaving like playground kids. It's against nationalism, but they had seen me moving around the table with the kids and thought I was leering at them like a dirty old man. At the end, there was this whole series of children's toys, and they thought the Jack in the Box was an obvious reference to masturbation. So it says a lot more about the minds of people who ran Top of the Pops than it did about my video. Despite this, Games Without Frontiers, no doubt helped by that whistling refrain and Bush's enigmatic utterances, would go on to be Peter Gabriel's highest charting UK single, tied with 1986's Sledgehammer, both reaching number 4. Thematically, Peter Gabriel's third album can be divided into its respective sides. Side A dwells on issues on an individual level, the obsessive stalker of Intruder. Intruder, come and leave his mark. The media-fixated future political trigger man of Family Snapshot. If you don't get given, you learn to take, and I will take you. And the compulsive neurotic of No Self-Control. Opening with Games Without Frontiers, Side B is dissatisfied on a more societal level, after a critique of the racist thought cycle on Not One of Us. Look like we do, talk like we do, but you know how it is. The apex of this sentiment is the album's concluding track. Though Games Without Frontiers was the hit, Biko may be the album's most enduring statement. Oh, Biko, Biko, Biko. Bantu Stephen Biko was a black South African anti-apartheid activist in the 1960s and 70s. In 1973, Biko was placed under a banning order by the South African government, prohibiting him from publishing his writings and effectively silencing him. In August 1977, he was arrested by South African authorities. He died on the 12th of September, after being savagely beaten by police, while under interrogation. The death would be international news, coming to the attention of Gabriel. The solemn Biko is the result. Though motivated by the situation surrounding Biko's death, Gabriel felt at first he might not be the right person to write such a song. It was only after talking to pub rock protest singer Tom Robinson that he changed his mind, telling Gabriel that he shouldn't worry what people might think about his motives, just to do it and make sure the resultant attention and money is going to the right cause. It's a white, middle-class, ex-public schoolboy, domesticated English person observing his own reactions from afar. It was business as usual in police room 619. It seemed impossible to me that the South Africans had let him be killed when there had been so much international publicity about his imprisonment. He was very intelligent, well-reasoned, and not full of hate. His writing seemed very solid in a way that polarized politics often doesn't. Despite being written at a distance, Gabriel did his best to research the life of Biko, reading several biographies. The music that bookends the piece are traditional Xhosa songs that were sung at Biko's funeral. While the repeated Xhosa phrase, means come spirit, a plea for his spirit to hear and aid them in the struggle. While it does swell to a life-affirming conclusion, there's a starkness to the composition, allowing the message to remain center stage. Somber synthesized bagpipes come in during the second verse, a staple of especially Scottish funerals, but their connection to South African culture is less obvious. We tried to figure out how it tied into this story about Stephen Biko and South Africa. After a little bit of research, it turned out that during the Boer War in South Africa between the British colonial, Dutch and German forces, one of the Scottish military units was very instrumental. So we went, okay, there's a hook. So we had a historical legitimacy of using a bagpipe sound other than that works musically. On presenting the completed album to his US label, Atlantic, they were confused by the dark political themes and unfamiliar sounds. Atlantic Records didn't want to put it out at all. Atlantic president Ahmet Ertegun said, "What did people in America care about this guy in South Africa? And has Peter been in a mental hospital? Because there was this very weird track called Lead a Normal Life."
Eating with a spoon, they don't give you knives.
They thought I'd had a breakdown and recorded a piece of crap. I thought I'd really found myself on that record. And then someone just squashes it. I went through some primordial rejection issues. Admittedly, Gabriel's relationship with Atlantic had been strained during the recording of the record, to the point of antagonism. They wanted another Salisbury Hill, or at least something that would fit with the rock radio landscape of 1980. And Through the Wire was deemed the most commercial track, and so it had been suggested it should sound more like the Doobie Brothers. Instead, Gabriel got the closest punk firebrand he had at hand, The Jam's Paul Weller, who was recording Setting Suns in the studio down the hall, to perform some suitably uncommercial, jagged riffage. Also, perhaps not helping matters, Gabriel's team would turn the air conditioning to freezing whenever their US A&R guy would come to visit, to prevent him outstaying his welcome. Deeming the record commercial suicide, Atlantic would not release it in the US and dropped Gabriel. Therefore, the album's release was delayed as he scrambled to find a replacement distributor. But he would get the last laugh. Then, when Games Without Frontiers was a hit here and started to get radio play in the States, they tried to buy the LP back. Charisma wouldn't let them get their hands on it, which gave me considerable satisfaction. Now I'm with Mercury over there. Peter Gabriel's third self-titled album was released at the end of May 1980. Due to its cover image, a hypnosis composition of Gabriel's features half dripping down his face, it would be known by fans as Melt. Gabriel's tendency to not name his albums had been another bugbear for Atlantic, as it's very hard to market an album without a title. As such, Melt would be his last self-titled record in the US and Canada. New label Geffen forcing him to officially title the next one Security, though it remained untitled for the rest of the world. But Melt becoming a UK number one album and number 22 on the Billboard chart showed that Gabriel could continue being a commercial force even with daring new sounds. This began an upward trajectory for his other two 80s albums, 1982's Security, which came with his biggest US hit yet, Shock the Monkey. And the world-conquering So from 1986. Despite not being his most commercially successful, Melt remains his most influential and perhaps greatest full-length, with frequent placings on best ever lists. The gated reverb sonics developed on this album by Lily White, Pagum, Gabriel and Collins would become the drum sound of the early 80s. Collins, instantly knowing that it sounded fucking awesome, would use it copiously on his solo work, beginning with his debut single, In the Air Tonight. While Public Image Limited's 1981 post-punk classic, Flowers of Romance, was held up by this whip-cracking snare and toms. Gabriel giving back to the scene he'd been so inspired by. Biko was influential at least twofold. Though Peter Hamill and Steel Pulse had previously written about him, Gabriel's song gave greater attention to a situation that wasn't really in the public consciousness at the time. Bono called and told me that U2 had learned about apartheid and Africa from the Biko song. Not only were artists more aware of the segregation and violence in South Africa, Biko indirectly led to a boycott of international acts playing the nation while apartheid was still in effect. Also, the combination of African traditional music with Western rock music present on Biko would predate Paul Simon's Graceland and Gabriel's own So by 5 years. Because of his newfound appreciation of non-Western music, Peter Gabriel would launch the World of Music, Arts and Dance, or WOMAD Festival in 1980. Though never really profitable, it would put a spotlight on African, Asian and South American artists, like the drummers of Burundi, Imrat Khan and Yusor Nador, and for better or worse, create the marketing categorization of world music. Modern alternative acts like Gorillaz, A Perfect Circle, Imogen Heap, Elbow, TV on the Radio, and Coldplay have taken Gabriel's far-reaching experimentation to heart. Vampire Weekend even name-check him on Cape Cod, Kwasa Kwasa. Flattered by the gesture, Gabriel would later cover the song with Hot Chip, though changing the lyric.
And it feels so unnatural to sing your own name.
As the 1980s continued, his former band got progressively more pop, culminating in 1986's Invisible Touch album, while Collins inadvertently became the face of 80s yuppie rock. But as high in the charts as Gabriel climbed, he was always a startling oddity, an art rock shadow of his former drummer. Gabriel wasn't covering Motown staples, and his ballads were Dust Bowl gospel duets with his female counterpoint in 6-8 time, reassuring us that Thatcher can't be in power forever. And Games Without Frontiers shows exactly why Peter Gabriel is so unusual, yet so important. A multilingual, whistling, lurching masterpiece. A prog rocker attempting synth pop about children's games and the horrors of war. It's not what Atlantic wanted, and it's definitely not empty pop music. It's Peter Gabriel finding himself. It's a knockout. Thanks for watching. What do you always miss hear Kate Bush singing on Games Without Frontiers? For me, it's She's So Popular. Comment your Mondegreens down below. If you like this video, like, subscribe, and why don't you also do me a favor and share it with a couple of people? It really does help. As always, I'd like to shout out this month's new supporters over on Patreon. Laurie McLean, Anthony Roberts, and Zio Janza van Rensburg. Thank you, and thank you to all that support me. And I'll see you in 3 weeks' time for a classic of third wave ska.